Hey everyone, and welcome back to Pharmacology. Today we're going to just talk a little bit about routes of administration of drugs, and then we're going to go kind of system by system and talk about the different drugs that we commonly use in veterinary medicine. I'm not sure if you guys have the Applied Pharmacology book, but if you do, I invite you to look at chapters 1 to 2. It'll go through the different routes and techniques that we use for drug administration, some of which you're going to be pretty familiar with already, and some of the reasoning behind why we do what we do and what we give how may be a little bit more new to you. So I invite you to look at that if you can. Otherwise, there's some good sections in McKernan that you can look at as well. So the route of administration of any particular drug is determined by several factors. First, and maybe most obviously, the available forms of a drug. So if we're looking to give a drug and we'd like to give it orally, but no oral form exists, then obviously that's not the way we're going to give that drug. We need to look at the properties of a specific drug. So if you can imagine, one of the most important properties would be bioavailability. So if a drug is only like 10% bioavailable by mouth, well then that's not one that you're likely going to give orally. You'll probably be giving that one by injection. So we also need to figure out, on a case-by-case basis, how quickly do we need the drug to work? So if we need a quick onset of action, then we're going to lean towards maybe an injectable form. Versus, if we have a bit of time, oral might work fine for us. We need to look at the species that we're treating. So the patient that we're treating, like its species, disposition, any other health conditions that it has. So every case is different. But say we're dealing with some sort of wildlife, we're not going to want to fool around trying to give it a pill. It might be easier to try to give something by injection, for instance. And we have to look at the condition being treated. So, I mean, if we're, for instance, treating a, I don't know, like a gastrointestinal problem where they're having malabsorption, maybe the best route is not oral to give a medication if they're having trouble absorbing things already. So these are all things to think about. The oral route is probably the most familiar to most people, especially outside of our profession. So pills, liquids, that kind of thing, the stuff that we dispense every single day. So the mucosa of the digestive tract is actually a large absorptive surface area, and it has a lot of blood supply going to it, which allows it to absorb things, which is, of course, what our digestive tract is designed to do. Anything that we give orally is not absorbed as quickly as by injection, but the effects do tend to be longer lasting. So that's a trade-off, and you got to think about what you need for each animal. The absorption of drugs in the GI tract is influenced by stomach pH, which is, of course, as we know, is very low. Drug solubility, size, shape, the patient's gastrointestinal motility, what disease we're trying to treat again, and whether there's food in the stomach. If we have a patient who is vomiting, having diarrhea, we need to steer clear of the oral route. And that just makes sense because it's not going to have much effect if they can't keep it down. Here's just a little visual on different dosing forms for oral medications. Let me get my laser pointer. Tablets are probably the most common form of medication that we dispense. They're scored tablets, so these are easily broken into halves or quarters. These can be halved. This one can be quartered, potentially. There are non-scored tablets, so regular tablets that actually, these are usually quite easy to break into two as well. But anything beyond that's a little tricky. And then there's capsules, right? That's got like little granules in it or whatever. Of course, we've got liquid and we've got powders as well. I had some drug administration videos that I could stick in here, but I think by now you guys are all pretty familiar with giving things orally and giving things by injection. So here is a intravenous injection. So this person has gotten the needle in the vein, drawn back, and here we go. We have a flash of blood, and we know we're good to go. So we can give that injection in the vein. We've got intramuscular, subcutaneous, intradermal. Intradermal is not terribly common. Probably the most common time that we use intradermal is for skin testing in allergy dogs. So allergy testing, we do intradermal injections. Intraperitoneal, this is not done commonly in small or large animal. It's done in like mice, laboratory animals quite a lot, and some exotics. Intra-articular, this is something that's used a lot in horses. So we give injections into joints in horses, usually to block pain and inflammation and things like that. Intracardiac is done in various species as needed, usually in emergency situations or potentially sometimes if we're trying to euthanize a smaller animal. Intramedullary or intraosseous, IO, that is used fairly commonly in birds because they have a hollow bones. They have hollow bones, so you can actually put fluids right into the bone. And then, of course, epidurals, which we use fairly routinely in small and large animals. So I'm not sure how many of you have done those yet, but anytime you're doing, you know, orthopedic stuff to the hind legs and stuff, epidurals are a really great way to give pain relief. Then there's inhalation. So that involves converting a liquid into a gaseous form using a nebulizer or a vaporizer. Most of the time it's anesthetics that we do this way, but also sometimes bronchodilators and steroids. So if you have an asthmatic cat, like this one over here, chances are you're going to use inhalation treatments to help the open up their bronchi and help keep them breathing nicely. And cats actually get used to this stuff fairly quickly. This guy doesn't look too upset about it anyway. So the topical route is, of course, another route of administration of drugs that we will use pretty much every day. The first thing you tend to think about is skin. So if we have a skin issue, we can use ointments and sprays, creams, that sort of stuff, to help heal skin issues. Mucous membrane. So there's certain drugs that get absorbed really nicely over mucous membranes, so we can put them topically on mucous membranes, like buprenorphine, given under the tongue or sublingually in cats, or sometimes in the cheek pouch, and it gets absorbed through the buccal mucosa. So it can get absorbed by putting it topically, it can end up systemic. Rectum. So there are certain drugs that we will use per rectum, probably the most common example being diazepam for seizures. So a seizuring dog might come in and we don't have access to a vein. We can always take the dose of Valium that we want to give in the vein, or potentially a little more actually, and give it per rectum. Another thing that we do that way is Capstar. So you might remember Capstar is a little pill that kills fleas. And it kills fleas very effectively and very quickly, usually within 20 to 30 minutes of oral administration. If we can't get it in the mouth, say they're under anesthesia or something, then we can actually give it per rectum, and it works quite effectively. Eyes. So ophthalmic drops, very common, obviously, with any eye infection. We can give drops in the eye. Apomorphine, you may or may not remember. Of course, it's an opioid, but it's used to get dogs to vomit. Dogs primarily. I can use it in other species, but usually we use it in dogs to make them vomit after they've gotten into something. So that can actually be put right in the conjunctival sac. Ears. Antibiotic drops, antiparasitics, these go in the ears. We've all seen this done. Transdermal, so the most common for that, probably fentanyl patches for pain management, especially post-operatively in dogs, say, who've had orthopedic surgeries or something like that. We can send them with a fentanyl patch, and it just slowly releases fentanyl through the skin into the bloodstream for about 72 hours or so. And then methimazole for cats. You can have hyperthyroid cats who, for whatever reason, can't be pilled or you can't control with food. Those ones we sometimes give methimazole through the pinna, so on the ear, the inside of the ear. We'll put a little bit of transdermal gel there, and we can actually control hyperthyroidism in some cats quite effectively that way. And again, if you want to take down these videos, these links to the videos, you can certainly do that. I'm not going to show them to you here. And again, that's mostly because you are pretty familiar by now on how to do these things. So how to give medications to dogs, cats, even rabbits, some of you maybe even rodents. So I'm not going to force you to look to look at this, but I do recommend that if you're unfamiliar with any of these, that you have a look at the link that I've provided. And here's just a few more, so feel free to pause the video, take down these YouTube links if you want, and watch away if you feel like you need extra help. All right, I just want to give you some visuals now on some of the medications that we'll be talking about. Here's my laser pointer. So eye and ear meds. I don't go into a whole lot of detail in this lecture about eye and ear meds, so I'm just going to quickly go over some of them right here. Zyrlan is probably one that you guys have all seen now. It's the most common thing that's used in most practices for your run-of-the-mill external ear infection, so otitis externa. It's just like pretty much all of the ear meds, Mometamax being another example. It's got an antibiotic, an antifungal, and an anti-inflammatory. So it kind of covers your yeast, it covers your bacteria, and it covers that horrible, painful, itchy inflammation that goes on in these ears. The difference between Zyrlan and Mometamax is primarily that Zyrlan is a twice-a-day medication, Mometamax is once a day, which means it tends to be a little bit more expensive, but Mometamax is also pretty effective against Pseudomonas, which is a rod-shaped bacteria that has a thick cell wall or capsule. And Mometamax can actually help to treat Pseudomonas infections more effectively than Zyrlan can. Optimmune is an eye medication, as is Suloxone. So Optimmune, if you remember, or if you don't, it's cyclosporine. Cyclosporine is an immune suppressive medication. We use this in animals with dry eye or keratoconjunctivitis sicca. It works quite nicely to help stimulate tear production in those animals. Suloxone is an antibiotic drop. So it's just a plain old antibiotic. It's ciprofloxacin, and it's one of the more common drops that I specifically use in practice. Here's some examples of topical medication. I like this one a lot. I don't know how many vets use it as much as I do, but it's a combination of a glucocorticoid and an antibiotic, and it's a spray. So for those hot spots and stuff, if they're just small, this will just take care of those really nicely with the antibiotic and the anti-inflammatory glucocorticoid in there. So love Topigen spray. Usually put it on sort of an open hot spot or something about 3 to 4 times a day until it's healed. Flamazine is silver sulfadiazine. It's really nice for burns. So if you have an animal that comes in with like any kind of a burn, maybe they were on a heating pad during surgery at another clinic. I've seen this before, and they come in with burns. This is a really nice cream that helps to heal burns. Panilog cream is just a nice antibiotic and steroid combination in a cream form that's good for a lot of just superficial abrasions and wounds and stuff like that. And Fusiderm gel is probably one of the more common ones that you'll see in practice. It's fusidic acid, which is an antibiotic, and betamethasone, which is a steroid. So again, we use this to treat surface pyodermas, so basically superficial skin infections that are caused by bacteria. Right, now we're going to move on to looking at drugs in terms of their target organs or systems, and that way it helps you to kind of classify them in your mind and remember them, I think, a little bit better. We'll start with immune-mediated disease, one of my favorite groups of diseases, as you've all learned through my excitement about immunology. What I'm a little less excited about is our treatment options for these diseases. Obviously, we have to suppress the immune system. So we have to do this, obviously, to get the disease under control. And our goal is going to be to control that disease without significant side effects. And that's where it gets a little bit tricky and expensive, unfortunately. So Our mainstay of treatment for immune-mediated diseases is going to be our glucocorticoids, our steroids. These are the most commonly used immune suppressive drugs, largely because they work great and they're cheap. Now, that being said, they're not without their drawbacks, and we'll talk a bit more about that. There are short-acting steroids or glucocorticoids like hydrocortisone. There are intermediate acting ones, so those are our common ones like prednisone and prednisolone, methylprednisolone, triamcinolone. These are things that you'll see, they'll be given orally, they'll be in topical preparations, and that kind of thing. Then we have our long-acting steroids. The most common one that you'll see again is dexamethasone. We use it a lot of times injectably, and most of the time, you can give it once a day, so it's a nice long-acting steroid. Works really great for a lot of different conditions. Betamethasone is used in a lot of topical preparations, so skin and ear, and sometimes eye medications if we need a steroid to kind of tone down inflammation or the immune response. Glucocorticoids are generally eliminated from the body quite slowly, so that's important to remember. What are some examples of glucocorticoids? Some of these you'll be very familiar with, prednisone and prednisolone. Remember, the difference between prednisone and prednisolone is that prednisolone is the active form of the drug and prednisone is a prodrug. So the body, basically the liver, has to convert it into its active form. And remember again, cats do not do this effectively. Dogs can, cats don't. So remember to give prednisolone if you're giving oral steroids to a cat. And if you're giving topical steroids, it will always be prednisolone. Why? Well, because if you're putting something on topically, it's not going to have a chance to go through the liver and to turn into the active form. So you always have to use it in its active form in those cases. Then we have dexamethasone, which I mentioned. We often use it injectably. Betamethasone, also commonly used topically. Methylprednisolone. Depomedrol, you'll see this used all the time. It's used in cats, not dogs. I believe it's not really used in any other species besides cats commonly. It's great. It lasts in the system for, 4 to 6 weeks, so it really tones down allergic responses and stuff after we give it by injection. And it lasts quite a while, so really handy that way. And there are cats that will come in for injections of Depomedrol every 4 to 6 weeks, pretty much for life. It's not ideal, but sometimes it's all we've got. And then Vinectal-P, which we use in dogs, it's a combination of prednisolone and an antihistamine. And what it does is it obviously tones down the immune response, primarily with the antihistamine, but also there's a low dose of a prednisolone in there. And it also really gets at the inflammation that causes a lot of itching. So really, really effective in allergic dogs. Now, here's where we start to get into trouble. The side effects of glucocorticoids are sometimes not acceptable to owners, as you can imagine. There's PUPD. These dogs pee all over the house. Sometimes they have to go out to pee every hour or less. And that's day and night, right? So you have to be really careful. They'll drink like crazy. They're hungry all the time. They'll act like you've never fed them before. They pant. So sometimes owners call up and they're like, "I don't understand. My dog's panting like crazy." Always ask if they've been giving any medication because steroids will do that. Adrenal suppression. So if we give exogenous steroids, then what that means is the adrenal glands feel like, basically they don't have to work as hard. They don't produce as much cortisol because we're essentially giving exogenous cortisol. We're basically giving them the equivalent of cortisol externally. So what can happen is if you're giving steroids and all of a sudden you stop, the adrenal gland is not producing enough cortisol. So all of a sudden you're hypoadrenocorticism. You have hypoadrenocorticism, which is what? Addison's disease. So you can become, your patients can become Addisonian if you withdraw steroids too fast, and that's why we taper them off. These drugs also interfere with the protective mechanisms, let's say, of the gastrointestinal tract. So you can get GI bleeding and ulcers, and especially if you try to use these in combination with non steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs or NSAIDs, you use those two together and you're pretty much guaranteed to get some gastrointestinal upset. Diabetes, steroids actually interfere with the whole glucose metabolism within the body, and I'm not going to go into details on that. Just know that if you use steroids, especially long term, but it has been known to happen with even one injection of Depo-Medrol, you can actually get an animal developing diabetes. Now, it may or may not be reversible, but it's something to bear in mind. Delayed healing. So, if you're trying to treat a wound, an open wound, and you're putting a bunch of steroid on it, that actually will interfere with healing. Same as if you're giving immunosuppressive doses of a steroid orally and they have a wound, it might take longer to heal as well. And it can cause behavior changes. So, steroids can actually, you'll have an owner call up and say, well, Fluffy's acting really aggressively and, she never used to do that. Well, it potentially could be related to steroids as well. So these are drugs that work great, but they're not without adverse side effects and consequences. Well, now that we know that our steroids have a good amount of side effects and maybe a lot of contraindications, we should talk a little bit about other options for immunosuppressive drugs. So, these other drugs are used for animals that don't respond to glucocorticoids alone or experience significant side effects. They're also used when an animal needs to be on long-term immunosuppressants and the owners are concerned about the dog's, health long-term. These are sometimes better options, either in combination with glucocorticoids, so we can decrease the amount of steroid that we're giving, or as standalone drugs in some cases as well. So azathioprine, the trade name is Imuran. I don't use that name, so to me it's azathioprine. It is a pretty commonly used immune suppressive drug that we just get from human pharmacies usually. We add it to glucocorticoids. We don't tend to use this one alone. So we might start treating an animal, say for IMHA, with prednisone. But we might find that either it's not really working as well as we'd like, or we don't want to have to keep the animal on such a high dose, and then we'll add in azathioprine. And it's very commonly used in that context. So these animals will be on azathioprine pretty much long term in combination with steroid. It causes bone marrow suppression, which is kind of part of its job, to a point. But certainly it's something that really does need to be monitored. It can cause liver toxicity, diarrhea, pancreatitis, so it's not without its own sorts of risks. Cyclosporine A, you'll remember I've talked about Atopica before, and that's cyclosporine. Sorry, that there's a misspell on this slide. It should be sporin, not sprin. But anyways, there are some side effects to it as well. Anorexia, vomiting, diarrhea, these are side effects that tend to go away after the first few days of treatment. So, if we can hang in there, usually that will resolve. Gingival hyperplasia, as you might recall, means that the gums basically, there's overgrowth of the gums and they can look quite kind of a little bit gnarly. That being said, it's not a dangerous thing, and as long as it's not interfering with the animal eating or causing a lot of pain, it's not usually a big deal. And long term, we can see increased liver enzymes with Atopica. It's not clear to me, at least, how much that actually correlates with disease, but it is a risk. So that being said, azathioprine, cyclosporine, otherwise known as Atopica, are usually pretty good and routinely used alternatives in terms of immune suppression. I will add the same note I add pretty much every time I talk about Atopica. It's a brilliant drug. It works so great. I think almost every animal who needs immune suppression should be on it. However, it's very expensive, especially if we're talking about trying to give it to a large dog. If it's a small dog or a cat, we can maybe get away with it. So that's really my only real drawback with Atopica. So when do we use these immune suppressants? Obviously with immune-mediated disease. So IMHA, hopefully you remember what that is, immune-mediated hemolytic anemia. ITP, which is immune-mediated thrombocytopenia, so decreased platelet counts. pemphigus foliaceus, all of the pemphigus ones. You'll remember I talked about basically a bunch of immune-mediated diseases right at the end of immunology, and pemphigus, lupus. There's all kinds of things. There's different kinds of myositis and stuff like that. Neurological conditions. Anything that involves the immune system being overactive. Allergies, of course, atopy. So environmental allergies. These dogs are often itchy and just really uncomfortable. Happens in cats as well, I would say a little less commonly, but atopy for sure. Hypersensitivities. So these are a different kind of allergy. So it's more of an acute allergic reaction, maybe some food allergies. Chronic gastrointestinal conditions. These are relatively common and often respond very, very nicely to immune suppressants. So IBD, inflammatory bowel disease. Lymphocytic plasmacytic enteritis. There's also a lymphocytic plasmacytic stomatitis type thing, so gingivitis that you can see in the mouth. So that would respond usually quite well to immune suppression. Chronic colitis oftentimes responds to immune suppressants and any other inflammatory or immune-mediated condition. So there's a whole ton of them. And our options for treatment really are always the same: glucocorticoids or other immune suppressants. And so again, if we're doing it long term, which most of the time we have to with these guys, it's always nice to look at alternatives to glucocorticoids. So I'm just going to go into a little bit of extra detail on a few of these. Prednisone, again, also prednisolone, which is the active form. A low dose of it is antipruritic. So if we use a low dose, we're going to get at the itching that goes along with a lot of allergies. Medium dose is anti-inflammatory. So if we're having a pretty significant inflammatory reaction that's going along with an infection or maybe a neoplastic process or something like that, then we use kind of a medium dose of pred. And then if we need that immune suppression, we have to use high doses. And if you think about it, we're using high doses of a drug that causes things like PUPD and polyphagia, we're going to see pretty intense side effects usually with these high doses. Some animals actually have really pretty significant side effects with low doses too, unfortunately. So when you're dispensing prednisone or prednisolone, a couple of things to remember. Usually they come in 5 and 50 milligram strengths. Make sure you have the right one. Do not mix them with NSAIDs. I mentioned before that that's pretty much a recipe for gastrointestinal issues, bleeding, ulceration, that sort of thing. And remember, prednisolone is the active form and should be used in cats because they do not metabolize prednisone to its active form well in their liver. So give cats prednisolone, dogs can have prednisone. Cyclosporine, here we are with Atopica again. It's approved for atopy, which makes sense. It's called Atopica in dogs and cats, but it can be used for other immune-mediated diseases too. You can use NSAIDs with it, which so that's a benefit if we have, say, an arthritic dog who also happens to have, say, pemphigus or IMHA or something, then we can use this. We don't have to give that dog a steroid. The vomiting and diarrhea that goes along with it usually resolves with time. We talked about gingival hyperplasia. And we always want to monitor liver enzymes so that if they do start to go up, we need to look and see is there truly liver disease there? What's going on? All right, so that's Atopica. Too bad it's expensive. Dexamethasone. This is a very common glucocorticoid. It's used very often in clinic with acute allergic or immune-mediated disease. So this is the one like if an animal's coming in crashing with, say, Addison's disease or which is not immune mediated, but it's just an example, or maybe IMHA. We will start them right away on dexamethasone, and it'll do that toning down of the immune system that we require in order to save an animal's life. We use it a lot with allergic reactions, like vaccine reactions and stuff like that as well. It acts more quickly than prednisone. It also lasts longer. The effect is dose dependent, so there's a quite a big range of doses that we can give with dexamethasone depending on what we're looking for. We usually end up having to go to a fairly high dose if we're looking to suppress the immune system. And it comes as an injectable, and it does come as tablets. We don't use it as commonly as tablets because usually prednisone or prednisolone works quite well orally. Methylprednisolone, this is our Depomedrol that I mentioned a couple of times. It can last a long time in the body, 30 days or more. It's used in cats only. FAD is one of the most common uses for it. Any other allergy, we can try it out in as well. We use it often with asthma, especially with owners who just can't medicate on a daily basis. We can give this injection once every 4 to 6 weeks, and usually that's enough to keep things under control. Eosinophilic granuloma complex, which I don't know, I really don't like this disease, but here, this is an example of an eosinophilic granuloma on the tongue of a cat. That's one of the more common places to find it. These do tend to resolve on their own. They are thought to be immune mediated. Well, I don't know if the etiology is really fully understood, but they do respond to steroids. So they do respond to Depomedrol. These guys often get Depo, even if they don't really need it, because it will resolve on its own. That being said, especially when they get these in their mouth, they can be quite sore. These animals can go off their food. If they can't eat, it's interfering with them eating. It's really great that we can give them something. So we give them Depomedrol to make it so that they can eat again and to get rid of that more quickly. That being said, it'll go away and it'll probably come back, but it is one of our common uses for Depo. I did mention before there's a risk of diabetes mellitus with these drugs, and that's because they do alter glucose metabolism. They can actually increase blood glucose levels, which can lead to diabetes. And I haven't actually seen this clinically myself. I know that it happens. I would say as long as we're careful about the patients that we're using this in, usually it's a non-issue. Right, time to move on to a whole new topic. Let's look at infectious diseases, and we'll start with bacterial diseases. So, as we all know, we can take antibiotics to fight off bacterial diseases, but this is an area that we have to really be careful in, and we have to really focus on and understand, so that we don't basically cause more harm than good by over-medicating with antimicrobials. So, antimicrobials as a term, actually means any drug that's used to either kill or inhibit the growth of microorganisms. So it's not specific to bacteria. So if we're talking about antibacterials or antibiotics, that's usually we're talking about bacteria. If we're talking about antimicrobials, these are drugs that are used to kill these little pathogens that are causing disease, be they viruses or bacteria or fungi or parasites or whatever they are. So a substance is antibacterial. That substance can kill or inhibit the growth of bacteria, specifically bacteria, remember. And there are antibiotics and antibacterials. It's not the same thing. Antibacterial compounds include antibiotics. So all antibiotics are antibacterial compounds, but not all antibacterial compounds are antibiotics. Think about that. Maybe it sounds confusing, but if you think about it, just think about things like those alcohol gels that you put on your hand to kind of clean up your hands if you don't have access to soap and water or whatever. So there's sanitizing gels or whatever. That is an antibacterial compound, but it's not an antibiotic. Or there's antibacterial soaps that are antibacterial compounds, but they're not antibiotics either, so that makes sense. The goal of treating with antibacterials is to assist the body's natural defenses in the elimination of bacterial pathogens while minimizing the risk of toxicity. So we always want to minimize the risk of toxicity with any drug. But the key here is we're helping the body to get rid of this pathogen on its own by really trying to decrease the numbers and letting the immune system get ahead and get the upper hand on them. The most common side effects of any antibiotic is going to be vomiting and diarrhea. So if anyone ever asks you, what's the side effect of X drug and it's an antibiotic, you can say vomiting and diarrhea, you will always be right. There are some other ones with other antibiotics, but just something to bear in mind. The antibiotics will affect both bacterial pathogens and normal flora. Remember, we can't choose, right? We can't choose that we want to kill the bad guys and keep the good guys. We're going to kill all the guys, and then we have to rebuild our good bacterial populations. So, because of that, a lot of antibiotics are directly irritating to the GI tract, or they kill off the normal flora and sort of as a result are irritating to the GI tract. They can cause anorexia. There are a lot of dose-dependent and idiosyncratic reactions to antibiotics. One example would be Vatril and rifloxacin in cats. It can cause blindness. So very important to be aware of potential, I would call that an idiosyncratic reaction. So it's important that we know that those exist and we are really careful and prudent with the way that we use our antibiotics. Okay, we're moving on now to talk about antibiotic classes. The important thing here is not so much that you remember the names of all the classes, but try to remember the related drugs because that will help you remember what maybe potential side effects might be, what kind of spectrum of activity that antibiotic might have. So that's why we talk about antibiotic classes, and that's why it helps to kind of remember which ones are related. So let's start with the beta-lactams. So the beta-lactams are kind of like the first antibiotics that were identified sort of by accident. They're discovered by accident by somebody who grew mold in his lab and found out that it actually seemed to kill off bacteria. So beta-lactams are good for gram-positive aerobes and obligate anaerobes. So gram-positive aerobes, if you think about that, where do you think they're most likely found? Well, like on the skin, any surface that's kind of exposed to the air, right? Anaerobes are going to be found usually in your gastrointestinal tract, so and other places within the body. So these can sometimes be used inside and in the visceral organs as well. Penicillin being kind of the first one that was ever discovered, and then amoxicillin being the one that we use a little bit more commonly now. Aminopenicillin is a little bit of an enhanced kind of a penicillin. We also have potentiated beta-lactams, so they're also effective against penicillinase producing staphylococcus and gram-negative aerobes. What that means is that certain bacteria have adapted or just are simply able to produce an enzyme that breaks down penicillin, which means that penicillin's not going to work against those bacteria. So if we add another drug to the amoxicillin in this case, so that's clavulanate that we add, that broadens the spectrum of activity and makes that drug now effective against those penicillinase producing bacteria. So those are our Clavamox. So you might have seen that in clinic, Clavamox or Amoxiclav or Aventiclav. Those are all amoxicillin clavulanic acid. Cephalosporins are also beta-lactams. They're just kind of the next generation. And within cephalosporins, we have three generations. So our cephalosporins, similar spectrum of activity to the initial kind of original beta-lactams, but a little bit broader. First generation, we have our cefazolin, and that's our IV cephalosporin that we use all the time in clinic for anyone who needs IV antibiotics. And then we have cefalexin, our kind of go-to drug for skin. Our second generation cephalosporins, cefoxitin is probably the most common, but we don't use that very often. And then third generation, these are the newer ones, not that we have any really new antibiotics, but these are kind of the newer ones. Ceftiofur, cefovecin. So cefovecin is one that you'll see all the time. It's known as Convenia. It's our injectable one that lasts for 3 weeks. So that's beta-lactams, and they're kind of, again, the original antibiotics. Aminoglycosides are the ones that we tend to go to if we have gram-negative aerobes. So luckily we don't see a whole lot of infections with gram-negative aerobes because aminoglycosides generally are quite toxic. So we don't like to use them unless we absolutely have to. Gentamicin we use in topical preparations, usually like in the eyes and stuff sometimes, sometimes on the skin. Amikacin we don't use very commonly at all. So again, we have to be careful about kidney toxicity and otic toxicity, so ear toxicity with these drugs. So we only use them if we absolutely have to, and we usually use them in the context of a topical treatment. Then we have sulfonamides. This group of antibiotics actually have some other antimicrobial properties as well. So we get aerobes, gram-negative and gram-positive aerobes with these. But we also get some protozoa, so coccidia and those sorts of things, maybe giardia in some cases. But coccidia is really the one that we use sulfonamides for more than anything else. So sulfadiazine being the most common one that we use, you might have seen in clinics S125 or S250, and those are sulfadiazines. So they have some significant side effects, bone marrow suppression and hypersensitivity being a couple of them. So we don't tend to reach for them if we don't have to. Most of the time, coccidia infections do resolve on their own. So we only use these in some cases. I've actually seen animals coming in with kidney failure, acute kidney failure, because of sulfa drugs. So we tend to stay away from them, especially in young animals, if we can. Let their bodies mature and let them take care of the coccidia on their own. Amphenicols. So these are broad spectrum. They're effective against some resistant organisms, but there's a human risk to these. These are quite toxic again. So wear gloves if we ever have to use these. Chloramphenicol being the most common example. Then we have macrolides. So macrolides are things like azithromycin or Tylosin. They have a similar spectrum of activity to Clavamox, and they also work for mycoplasma. So mycoplasma can be a little bit difficult to treat in some cases. We tend to get lung infections and respiratory infections, that sort of thing, with mycoplasma. So if we can use macrolides in those cases to help treat those. The most common example in practice, probably azithromycin. I like to use that a lot with cats with upper respiratory infections. Any animal with upper respiratory infections can benefit from it. And interestingly enough, so can some dogs with papillomaviruses and things like that. I don't know exactly the mechanism whereby that works, but it can help with oral papillomas and things too. Tylosin is actually an antibiotic that's usually used in a feed for pigs and chickens and things like that. But you can get the powder really, really cheaply, and you can use it in dogs and cats if need be. Tylosin is great for IBD, any chronic diarrhea. So apparently it tastes terrible. I haven't tried it yet, but I wouldn't recommend tasting it, but absolutely, go ahead and try it with an IBD case, and owner might be happy that we found an antibiotic that's cheap and also works. The next group of drugs I want to talk about is lincosamides. So clindamycin is our prime example of this. These drugs are really great for oral infections. And just a note, this should be avoided in horses if you're working with horses, but if we're working with dogs and cats, clindamycin is a really nice drug for dealing with gingivitis or stomatitis, anything in the mouth. Another thing it's really good at is penetrating abscesses. So any animal that has an abscess, of course, unless it's a horse, I'd look to clindamycin to try to treat that probably before any other drug. Tetracyclines, we use one very commonly in vet medicine, and that's doxycycline. It's great for respiratory infections, so it's probably one of my first choices with a lot of respiratory infections, especially lower respiratory tract infections. It almost seems to have a bit of an anti-inflammatory effect in the lungs as well. You'll see pretty much any cat coming from the SPCA with an upper respiratory infection will come to you on doxycycline. So that's very common. But one thing in cats to note about doxycycline is that it can cause esophageal strictures. If that pill sits in the esophagus for long, it can actually cause a stricture and a narrowing of the esophagus. And you can imagine what kind of problems that would cause. So if you're giving a pill to a cat, a doxycycline pill, it must be flushed down with a lot of water. Or you can actually get solutions made up, which are safer. So oral liquids are usually a better bet for doxycycline in cats. The other place that I use a lot of doxycycline is in tick-borne diseases. So Lyme being one of those. Or, if you're seeing a lot of greyhounds in your practice, they come up here from the States with all kinds of tick-borne diseases. So anaplasma or, those sorts of things. If you are seeing any of those, the vet might decide to use doxycycline, and it's probably our best first-line drug for tick-borne stuff. Nitrometazoles, the only one we use commonly would be metronidazole, which is great for GI infections. And of course, any of you who've spent any time at all in clinic will have used the metronidazole in acute diarrhea situations or even chronic kind of IBD diarrheas. Beware, there is a dose-related neurotoxicity. This usually only becomes an issue if the animal is significantly overdosed. So with an overdose, we do see sometimes ataxia. If it's a big overdose, seizures, potential coma, it's bad. So I've never seen that. So as long as it's used within the prescribed range, you're most likely to not have that issue. Fluoroquinolones, so the examples of this would be enrofloxacin, which is Baytril, or marbofloxacin, which is Zenoquin. These would be our two most commonly used ones. They're great, they're broad spectrum, they do a really great job at killing actually quite a lot of different bugs in quite a lot of different systems in the body. So it's a great second line drug. We don't tend to use it first line. It's great second line drugs for potentially somewhat resistant infections. I mean, not very resistant infections, but if you have an infection that's not sensitive to a beta-lactam or one of the other first line drugs, this might be where we end up going. Enrofloxacin, Baytril, has a couple of major things to know about. Number one, it can cause cartilage damage in young animals. So if you have a puppy, say, that's still growing and developing, you might want to steer clear of enrofloxacin, which is again Baytril. It can cause chondrodysplasia. The other thing is that in cats, even at the recommended dose of 5 mg per kg once a day, it can cause blindness. So if you're needing a fluoroquinolone in a cat, probably better to reach for the marbofloxacin, which is Zenoquin. It tends to work just as well, and it doesn't cause blindness in cats. So something to bear in mind if your vet is trying to prescribe Baytril to a cat, you may want to remind him or her that maybe there's a better option. Both of these, so any fluoroquinolone could potentially cause seizures in an epileptic patient. So if you have an uncontrolled epileptic especially, these should probably be avoided. If you have a well-controlled epileptic, it's likely a non-issue. Just be aware. So on the next slide, there's going to be a video that's just going to sum up the different antibiotic classes.
So here we go. Here's our review. This is some review on pharmacology. Mostly we're going to talk about antibiotics. And I know you guys are thinking, oh god, there's so many. But you know what? That's going to be okay. Because we're going to go through it slowly. Alright? Now calm down. Alright. First of all, let's get covered on the two categories of antimicrobial drugs. First of all, we got bactericidal, and it's like, ah, I'm gonna kill you, rah! But then the bacteria is all like, oh no, because it gets killed. So yeah, that's what cidal means, means that it's a killer. Yeah. Then we got bacteriostatic over here, and it's the cock block of the antimicrobial world, because it inhibits growth, and most of the time it interacts with the protein synthesis, which makes stuff not have babies, so they can't procreate. So of course, her dreams of kids and marriage are gone. Alright, so as we continue, first, first group of antimicrobials is the beta-lactam family. And in this category, there are two of them. There's the penicillins and the cephalosporins. So as we go through these, I made like little symbols and stuff. So it can be given parenterally or orally. So the parental means that it can be given either IV, IM, or what's the other one? Sub-Q. And then it's also, what do you call that? Metabolized. There you go. It's metabolized by the liver and then also excreted through the kidneys. Then we've got some exploding action going on because it interacts with the cell wall and it lets a lot of stuff into the cell, and then the bacteria just kind of gives up and it explodes. And then takes care of gram-positive bacteria. And those are some examples. Lovely examples. All right, then we move on to cephalosporins, and then those are also given by injectable as well, and they're metabolized by the kidney. No, wait, no. Oh, I meant liver. Just testing you guys. So then they're metabolized by the liver, excreted through the kidneys. Let's see. Oh, so the tricky thing about this is that they're ninjas. They sneak through the cell wall, unlike that one where they just bind on the cell wall and then they just make it explode like that. They actually sneak in. They're kind of like little ninjas. And then they make the cell explode. Yeah, it's kind of awesome that way. So, then after that, let's see. Da, 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 da. Yep, and then it's effective against gram-positive and some gram-negative bacteria. And those are some examples. Yeah. Now we move on to the tetracyclines. It's kind of exciting. And then, let's see. So some of the things that you can do with tetracyclines, you can give it by injection. You can also give it orally. Then it's metabolized by the liver, then excreted through the kidneys. Woo! And it's bacteriostatic, which means it stops the baby-making process. So it's effective against gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria. And also, it's distributed quickly through the tissue and sometimes penetrates into the central nervous system, which I drew a picture of a brain now. But yeah, and then one thing that you have to, well, there are a couple of things that you have to worry about. But like one of the things that you have to worry about with that is that it's renal toxic in high doses. And it can cause fever in cats. And please never give to horses, otherwise there will be bad, bad things happening. And then it also affects bone and teeth in young animals. There's some examples right there. Don't really feel like pronouncing them. All right. So next we move on to aminoglycosides. Okay, so it can be given, well, let's see, parenterally and topically. That's what the little thing is. It's actually like a little topical medication thing. But most of the time, it's actually absorbed into the bloodstream, so no liver involved here. So after it's absorbed into the bloodstream, then it goes to the tissues that need it most. And then after they do that, then it gets transported from the bloodstream to the extracellular fluid, and then it goes to this the CSF, the respiratory secretions, either that or like eye solutions and whatnot. And then it gets excreted through the kidneys. Ha! All right. And then it makes the cells explode. It's kind of awesome. Yep. Let's see. Then it's effective against gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria. The thing is that you have to have strong kidneys in order to do this, so any patient with kidney failure, bad idea. No, bad idea. And then it also causes ototoxicity because sometimes they like to gather. That's like the little things over. Oh, there we go. That's like the little things over here. Little aminoglycoside bacteria. Yeah, they're killing the bacteria, but they like to gather in the ear. So sometimes that could cause deafness. And those are some examples. Whee! All right, and then the next one is the fluoroquinolones. Quinid. Okay, say that like say that 5 times fast. Fluoroquinolones. All right, I think I got it. All right, so it can be given parenterally or orally. Yay! And then it's absorbed by the tissue, which that's like absorbing action right there. Then it's metabolized by the liver and excreted through the kidneys. Woo! Is bactericidal. Oop, let me zoom in. Bactericidal. Oh, it's gonna kill stuff. So it means that it's effective against gram-positive and gram-negative. Woo! Try not to use it in young animals. Don't use in dogs with seizures. Those are some examples of it. Let's see if I forgot anything. Looks like it's used for bacterial skin and soft tissue infections, respiratory infections, cystitis. And in cattle, it's used for feedlot heifers, respiratory disease, and it's banned for use in poultry. Good to know. All right, so it looks like we're time to move on to chloramphenicol. So, yeah, there we go. We got all of it. So, chloramphenicol is usually only given orally. When we say topically, it's usually for the eye. And apparently, this drug is kind of a bad drug, so it's rarely used, but sometimes it can only take care of like some aspects of different things of bacteria because they're not really immune to it yet. So yeah, little tidbit there. And then metabolized by the liver, excreted through the kidney. And it's also bacteriostatic. Ooh, it stops the baby makers. So it's effective against, let's see, gram positive and gram negative. Oh yeah, that was like a little thing that I put in there. And then some bad stuff about it is that it causes bone marrow suppression and or anemia and optic and peripheral nerve inflammation. Yeah, that kind of sucks. But one of the things is aplastic anemia is nasty. No one wants to get aplastic anemia. So there are no solutions because most of the time this is a generic thing. And yeah. About it for that one. It's basically used for bacterial respiratory infections, UTI, enteritis, conjunctivitis, and meningitis, and rickettsial disease? Yeah, I say that five times fast. Alright, now we move on to the next one. Ha ha ha. Zoom out. There we go, fluorophenicol. Yeah, there's not really that much there. But basically, there's only one type, just because, what do you call it? I guess it's a new drug or something like that, so there's only the new fluor injection. And it goes to all surrounding tissues, including the CNS and the cerebrospinal fluid. And it also is metabolized by the liver and excreted through the kidneys, and it's only available in injectable. It's bacteriostatic, so stops baby makers. Then, let's see, I think that's about it. It uses respiratory disease with. Associated with Pasteurella, and it's mainly used in feedlot cattle, apparently. All right, now on to the macrolides and lincomycin. That's a handful. So look, I'm not even gonna try and pronounce all of these. So yeah, just go ahead and read all that. Yep, lincomycin. I don't really know how to pronounce those either. So yeah, it's available for injection. I scrolled too far, hold on. Yep, it's given orally and some parenteral because you don't want to give it IV. Never give it IV. So IM and sub-Q are fine. So let's see. It's bacteriostatic, stops baby makers, and it's effective against gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria. Yeah, how you like that? Then the last one that we're going to talk about today. Is sulfonamides, and I drew like little hoof prints and stuff. Yeah, see those hoof prints? Yeah, I drew those. So it's only used in large animal. So a couple of things about it. That's why I drew a horse instead of a dog this time. So yeah, it's used. It can be given orally and some parenteral, because it can actually only be given what do you call it? IV. So yeah, because it's actually very irritating to tissue. So never, never give it IM. Or sub-Q, because then the horse will probably kick you and stuff. So that's never good. And it's also metabolized by the liver, excreted through the kidneys. And it's effective against gram-positive and gram-negative drugs. I meant to write bacteria. Ha! Oops. I'm tired. It's hard to erase and look at the same time. All right, there we go. Oh, let's see. Immunity to this drug is starting to take place, so we don't want to use it all the time. But those are the different types of drugs that are out there. And it's actually used for, let's see, UTIs, nocardiosis in combination with, oh wow, toxoplasmosis? Let's see. And a lot of stuff that I can't really pronounce, so we're not going to worry about that right now, okay? All right, kids. That's it. Those are the major groups of the antibiotics. Woo! This was all chapter 12 last year. So that concludes this chapter 7.
So, just so you have a visual, these are some common antibiotics that you'll see regularly in most small animal clinics for sure. I'm going to get my laser pointer now. And so this over here is anti-rhobe aqua drops. And if you look closely, this is actually clindamycin. So clindamycin, if you remember, is great for two things, one being oral infections and the other being abscesses. So anti-rhobe aqua drops, liquid form of clindamycin. There's also just regular anti-rhobe, which is pills. So you'll see both. Cefazolin. So here's our first generation cephalosporin, cefazolin. And that's one of the most common injectable antibiotics, IV antibiotics that we'll use in clinic for kind of gastrointestinal stuff, especially like hemorrhagic gastroenteritis and that sort of thing. Here's our Baytril, our enrofloxacin. So that's our fluoroquinolone that we have to be very careful with using in cats, right? Because it can, as an idiosyncratic reaction, can cause blindness even at regular, normal, recommended doses. And in dogs, we worry more about chondrodysplasia, so basically interfering with the normal development of cartilage in young dogs. This is our alternative here, Xenoquin. Xenoquin being marbofloxacin, so related to Baytril, related to enrofloxacin, but marbofloxacin, so it doesn't have those same really bad effects of chondrodysplasia and blindness. Clavamox, very, very common. Beta-lactam with clavulanic acid, so amoxicillin clavulanic acid, and so that's just a more broad spectrum antibiotic, very commonly used as a first line drug in vet medicine. Doxycycline, you may remember there's two times we tend to use a lot of doxycycline, and that would be number one in cats with upper respiratory infections, and number two in dogs, especially with tick-borne diseases. So doxycycline, also remember, wash it down with lots of water in cats because it can cause esophageal strictures. Here's gentamicin. So we talked about gentamicin being available primarily as a topical solution, and usually that's in the form of eye drops or potentially topical skin ointments and things. So that's gentamicin and it's an eye drop. So just so you've seen them before, there they are. Moving on now to antifungal medications. You won't see these as often as you see antibiotics, obviously, but we do use them fairly regularly in practice, most commonly in kind of topical formulations. But here we are, antifungal drugs. So what these do, they bind to or inhibit the synthesis of ergosterol in the cell membrane. What that does is it alters membrane function and causes the fungal cell to die. This works nicely usually because we don't have those cell walls, which means that we aren't affected by antifungals. So the mammalian cell is not affected by this. Antifungals are divided into two groups based on their chemical makeup. So we have polyenes, it's kind of a funny word, and azoles, which are imidazoles and triazoles. The treatment takes a long time with antifungals, so it's important to remember that. It takes a long time and it's often quite expensive. Patients need to be monitored for side effects. A lot of antifungals end up being quite toxic ultimately. So we have to look for decreased appetite, anorexia, and vomiting. And it's really important to do periodic liver and kidney chemistries. We have to make sure we're preserving the function of these organs and not interfering with them. And that's true of a lot of different drugs, anything really that we're using long term. If we're looking for antifungal medication to treat ear infections or skin infections, most of the time we will try to go topical, unless it's a generalized problem like a skin infection that's affecting basically the entire animal. Then we'll go for maybe systemic. But if at all possible, we tend to try to use antifungals topically. Systemic infections can be treated with systemic antifungals. Again, expensive and a higher risk of toxicity than just antibiotics would have. Diseases we need to consider using antifungals for would be dermatophytosis, which is commonly known as ringworm. So remember, ringworm is not a parasite, it's a fungus. It just looks like kind of a ring on the skin. It used to be that they thought it was caused by an actual worm, which is why it's called ringworm. But don't get confused. If we have yeast ear infections or skin infections, we can use these obviously, and we do very commonly. Or disseminated fungal infections. These are bad. These are fungal infections that affect often the lungs, the upper respiratory tract and lower respiratory tract. And sometimes other organs in the body, so blastomycosis, cryptococcosis, coccidioidomycosis, aspergillosis, and histoplasmosis are some of the examples of these. If we have an animal with a disseminated fungal infection, these need a long treatment, it's a difficult treatment, but we do have success with this. So Luckily, we don't see that a lot around here. It's more common down south where they have more, fungi that actually survive year round, whereas here everything freezes and kind of disappears in the winter, which is good for us. Some common antifungals are listed here, and I'm going to give you some of their side effects. The point here is that antifungals are tricky. They cause a lot of side effects, and we have to do kind of a risk-benefit analysis when we use them. So amphotericin B is very effective antifungal. It's used in systemic mycotic infections, so systemic fungal infections, but serious side effects can be seen with this drug: anorexia, vomiting, seizures, anemia, cardiac arrest. So we have to be very careful when we're prescribing this drug. Kidney toxicity is especially common, so we have to monitor the kidney function in these guys. We have ketoconazole. So this one is used for systemic or kind of skin and potentially yeast infections. Side effects of ketoconazole are less severe and less common, but we can see liver toxicity with this. The one I prefer to those is itraconazole. It's newer. It's used for systemic mycotic infections. I actually use this if I have a really generalized ringworm infection. I'll use itraconazole orally. So it's newer. It's an imidazole. It's now fairly commonly used. We get anorexia sometimes with this because of toxicity to the liver. We can get vasculitis and possible cardiotoxicity sometimes with this drug. Although I would say, in my experience, the side effects of itraconazole are not bad. Big drawback, it is quite expensive. And remember, we have to treat fungal infections for usually several weeks to months. So that's kind of the one big drawback to it. Clotrimazole and nystatin, these are topical medications. You'll find them commonly in creams and things. So here's a case study about antimicrobial use, and it's going to give you an idea of the sorts of things you're going to need to know when you're dispensing antibiotics to clients. Here we have a cat owner who comes into the clinic requesting a refill of an antibiotic because her cat is sneezing again. The client explains that when the cat starts sneezing, she gives him antibiotics. She says she only needs about 14 pills because she only has to give her cat 2 to 3 days' worth of pills before he stops sneezing. 14 pills will give her enough antibiotic to treat the cat for a few bouts of sneezing. She would also like the strongest available antibiotic. How can the veterinary technician help this client understand that her rationale of antibiotic use is flawed? You're going to think that this owner is kind of silly, but this is the sort of scenario you will face in practice. So, questions. Number one, what is the best way to explain to this client how antibiotics work? What side effects can be expected, and why stronger is not necessarily a good term to use in describing antibiotics. I think a lot of us are actually guilty of doing that from time to time. It's so easy to fall into, well, this is a stronger antibiotic. Well, technically, that's not how it works, and we'll talk about that on the next slide. And what are some of the consequences of this kind of antibiotic use that the owner's suggesting here? The first question is kind of asking how we want to explain how antibiotics work. So we'd say antibiotics work on bacteria in a variety of different ways. So they target different bacterial structures, making the effectiveness among different types of bacteria variable. So that's why a certain antibiotic might be good for one type of bacteria, maybe not for another. And antibiotics should not be thought of as stronger or weaker than one another. Rather, it's more as a narrow spectrum or a broad spectrum. So, as a narrow spectrum antibiotic, it'll work only on, say, gram-positive or gram-negative bacteria, whereas a broad spectrum bacteria might work on both, but maybe not all of the different bacteria within gram-positive and gram-negative. So, basically, narrow spectrum versus broad spectrum is a better way of thinking of it rather than, stronger or weaker antibiotic. The best way to treat a bacterial infection is to know exactly what organism's present, so we need to do that through culture, and we've talked a bit about that in lab procedures. Without culture, antibiotics can be dispensed basically for best guess. Like this is the bacterial organism that we think is most commonly associated with this condition. We do a lot of that for financial reasons in practice, but ideally we would culture everything. We want to use the antibiotic that has the best chance of targeting a particular bacterium and getting to the affected area. So if I'm trying to get at something in the bladder and I have a drug that doesn't that's not water soluble, well, that's not going to get in there. So basically we want to find the right bacteria that's going to get to the right place and kill the right organism. So it's unclear in this case what the owner means by the strongest antibiotic. Is she talking about the broadest spectrum to maximize the potential to inhibit that pathogen, or is she talking about the one that works without causing side effects? Who knows, right? So that's why strongest, again, is not a great word to use. And remind the client in this case that antibiotics do not cure sneezing. So sneezing, you might remember, is part of our first defense against pathogens that we talked about in immunology. So sneezing and other defenses like nasal discharge and coughing are actually ways an animal can protect itself from contracting an infection or from worsening an infection that's present. So those are defense mechanisms. Question two was asking what the consequences are of this kind of inappropriate antibacterial or antimicrobial use. So the big one that we worry about, and this is a global problem, it's a problem in human medicine, it's a problem in livestock, but basically we're looking at antibiotic resistance. This is a huge, huge problem. So antibiotics should always be prescribed and taken at the proper dose and for the proper amount of time. If we don't give an antibiotic for the minimum length of time it's going to take to have its effect, then we're not using that antibiotic effectively, and some of the bacteria will survive, and they will probably be resistant bacteria, and they will grow, and they will cause a worse infection that's resistant to that antibiotic. Recheck examinations will let the veterinary staff determine whether or not that infection has indeed been eliminated. So it needs to be monitored. Treatment with antibiotics has to be monitored. Alteration of normal bacterial flora, which can lead to this cat developing other health issues, can occur if you don't use these antibiotics correctly, like vomiting and diarrhea are probably the most common side effects of antibiotics, right? This alteration of normal bacteria can also allow overgrowth of yeast in some areas of the body, so really commonly places like ears and interdigital skin and stuff like that. And that might require treatment with an antifungal medication. And of course, antifungals are not without side effects, right? So they're expensive, they have lots of side effects, so we don't want to use them if we don't absolutely have to. We're moving on now past antimicrobials and into endocrine diseases and their treatments. So this is one of my favorite areas of medicine. I really enjoy endocrinopathies. So I'll talk about these and hopefully you'll enjoy it as well. First of all, we have thyroid disease, hugely common. Cats, dogs, horses, probably a lot of other animals as well, but those are the ones, of course, that I'm most familiar with. Hypothyroidism. So that just means low circulating thyroid hormone concentrations. This is very common in dogs and in horses. And we treat it with thyroid hormone supplementation. So that is synthetic L-thyroxine. Hyperthyroidism is increased circulating thyroid hormone concentrations. So the opposite of hypothyroidism. This is the most common endocrine disease diagnosed in cats, and especially as cats get older, it's very, very common for them to develop hyperthyroidism. And methimazole is probably our most common treatment, but there's also radioactive iodine therapy, which is available at PetWorks here in Halifax, or technically in Dartmouth. And there's a food available from Hills called YD, which basically, as long as an owner feeds that and only that, can in itself control hyperthyroidism. Here is levothyroxine. So that's ThyroTabs most commonly in clinic. So on the bottom left there, you'll see ThyroTabs. Also available, Suloxone. These are the same drug, just different makeups here, different brands. And they do come with side effects. So hyperthyroidism being the side effect if you overdose on these medications. Otherwise, side effects are rare. So sometimes, if we're not 100% sure if a dog is hypothyroid, we will start that dog on levothyroxine and kind of see the response because there's not a whole lot of risk to it. We just have to monitor thyroid levels and make sure we're not overdosing. When it comes to hyperthyroidism, I mentioned radioactive iodine therapy. This is an inpatient procedure, takes a couple of days. The cat stays at PetWorks, at least in this part of the world, at PetWorks in Dartmouth, and has iodine injected IV, and basically it attacks the thyroid tissue and gets rid of the excess thyroid tissue. A diet low in iodine, so that's YD, can be used because iodine is basically an essential building block for the thyroid hormone, and if the body doesn't have iodine, it can't make thyroid hormone, which will decrease the systemic levels of thyroid hormone. So there you go. YD only works if the owner is extremely careful to only feed YD and YD canned and YD treats, but nothing else. If that cat so much as licks the dishes in the dishwasher, it will not work. So it's a little tricky that way, but it's a good option for some clients. Then we have methimazole, our most common treatment, which comes as tapazole or phimazole. Some people have no problem giving pills to cats. However, for those people who absolutely cannot give a pill to a cat, there is a topical preparation, a gel that you can put on the inside of the ear, and it gets absorbed transdermally. And for certain cats, it works all right. For some other cats, it just never really gets the hyperthyroidism under control. There are some possible side effects, of course, with hyperthyroidism treatment. So anorexia, excoriations, that means the animal's scratching itself, lethargy, which again would be more likely in the case of overdosing causing hypothyroidism. There's vomiting, liver disease, and decreased blood cell counts. So unlike with the hypothyroid therapy, which is just supplementing the levothyroxine, with methimazole, there are some side effects to worry about, so we only use it when we are sure that we need it. The good news is it's much easier to tell in a cat if we need it than it is to tell if a dog needs treatment. Adrenal glands. So there are two main adrenal diseases. There's the increased function, which is hyperadrenocorticism, also known as Cushing's. This happens again in dogs and horses, and mitotane or trilistane is used for medical therapy in these cases. There's the decreased function, which is hypoadrenocorticism, so that's Addison's disease. It's spontaneous. We don't really know what causes it. It's most common in dogs. It also occurs sometimes in association with the treatment of Cushing's. If we overtreat for Cushing's, we can get Addison's. It's treated with either fludrocortisone or with prednisone and deoxycortisone. So this I will talk a little bit more about, so don't worry. So here we go. Hyperadrenocorticism, Cushing's. The treatment of choice these days is pretty much Veteril, which is trilistane. This decreases the production of cortisol, so an overactive adrenal gland is going to spit out a lot of cortisol. So this decreases production of cortisol by reversibly inhibiting the enzymatic conversion of steroid hormones to cortisol. So because it does it works that way. It treats both the pituitary and adrenal dependent hyperadrenal the HAC. It's the only drug that does this. So that's why we like trilistane. It treats both kinds of Cushing's, so we don't need to worry about which one we have necessarily. Side effects to trilistane or Veteril: lethargy, anorexia, vomiting, diarrhea. So pretty common side effects to a lot of drugs. There are some other drugs we can use. So Anapril. When I first started working, Anapril and Lysadrin were probably the ones that we used most commonly. So that's selegiline, Anapril, also used with senile dogs, and then lysadrin, mitotane. Mitotane is directly cytotoxic to the adrenal cortex, so it works only with adrenal dependent Cushing's. But works okay. They both still are used. But again, I'd say Vetoryl is our best choice. And of course, as with most drugs, it's also our most expensive. With Addison's disease, we have hypoadrenocorticism, which means that the adrenal glands are no longer producing enough steroids, cortisol, all the things that they need to produce for normal functioning of the body. So we have to start supplementing with the stuff that's not being produced. So DOCP is one great option that we do have. It's also called Percortin V. This provides mineralocorticoids, which is one of the two one of the two products that the adrenal glands produce that would be low in this condition. So we have mineralocorticoids and glucocorticoids that we need to supplement. So Percortin V will give us our mineralocorticoids. It's done by an IM or sub-Q injection every 25 to 30 days. It's a great option. It's a little expensive, of course. Prednisone will provide us with our glucocorticoids, so that's our typical steroids that we give for all kinds of things. It supplements the glucocorticoids, which essentially is our cortisol, and it's given orally daily. And then we give it usually in combination with DOCP injections every 4 weeks or so. Then we have fludrocortisone, which we can use if we need something oral. That's Florinef. Technically, it provides both mineralocorticoids and glucocorticoids. I can't say that word today. Florinef is given once a day. What I find with it is that often these animals still require prednisone, so it's good. To me, it's not as good as the Percortin and prednisone combination, but it does its job in some animals really, really well. So it's definitely a good tool for Addison's. If we get those animals that respond to Florinef alone, those are fantastic. Moving on to diabetes mellitus, this is kind of my pet disease, maybe because I had a pet that had this disease. But this is a disease of impaired carbohydrate, protein, and fat metabolism. It's associated with an absolute or relative insulin deficiency. So we all know diabetes, you treat with insulin, at least in some cases. In our profession, most cases get insulin. It does occur in many species, but most commonly it's diagnosed in dogs and cats. We'll go into the details of all this in the common diseases module, and I think a lot of you are familiar with this disease anyway. But treatment of diabetes really involves the optimization of diet, so usually a higher protein diet, lower carbohydrates, basically to regulate those blood sugars properly. Insulin injections, in most animals, we need these, even though cats technically get non-insulin dependent diabetes, they really do require insulin in order to be effectively treated. And ongoing monitoring of these cases is very important. How do we treat it? So obviously it's treated with insulin. Insulin is a whole world of drugs. There's a whole bunch of them out there, different durations, different concentrations. So it's very important to be able to navigate through these. You are going to spend a lot of time talking to owners about diabetes and how to treat it. So very important that you understand this. U40 versus U100 insulin, basically it refers to the number of units per mil. So U40 insulin has 40 units per mil, and U100 has 100 units of insulin per mil. So very important to know which type of insulin you're giving to an animal. Our animal insulin, our dog and cat insulin, that's made specifically for them, tends to be U40. And that's often for just dosing convenience. Otherwise, we're giving really, really tiny amounts. We need to make sure that when we're using insulin, that we're using the appropriate syringe. Syringes will be marked for U100 or for U40 insulin. So make sure we have the right syringes. These insulins can be fast or intermediate or long acting. So regular insulin is fast acting. It's also called Toronto insulin. The only time we really use this clinically is if we are treating an animal in clinic for DKA, so diabetic ketoacidosis. So this is a very significant complication of diabetes, and these animals are hospitalized, and we use fast acting regular insulin so that we can very tightly control the blood sugar levels. Regular insulin can be given IV, IM, or sub-Q. Then we have glargine or Lantus insulin. This is my go-to insulin for cats. It's long-acting, given sub-Q, and it's quite effective, I find, in cats. It is a human product. You get it from the drugstore, but it is very effective in treating diabetes mellitus in my experience in cats. I have had really great success with it, so I like it quite a lot. Kininsulin is a U40 insulin. So the other two are U100. This is a U40 insulin. It was originally designed for dogs. It's a porcine insulin, meaning it comes from pigs. It's intermediate acting. So this one's kind of in between. It's given sub-Q. So just to give you an idea of duration of action, our long-acting insulin, Lantus, its activity lasts for about 18 hours, whereas kininsulin is about 12. So you might think, like, how do we dose for every 18 hours? Well, it usually ends up being twice a day, and we manage that just fine. With kininsulin, twice a day again. Regular insulin, it can be used very, very frequently. And again, that's why it's used in hospitalized patients. Another case study for you. We have a 5-year-old male neutered dachshund who comes into the clinic for an exam. He's been lethargic and seems to be gaining weight. And upon weighing him, the vet tech discovers that he hasn't gained weight since his last appointment, but his abdomen is hanging lower than it used to. Still a bit overweight, but he has been for many years. The owner says he's been drinking a lot and peeing a lot. So, on physical exam, the vet tech finds the TPR is normal, but there are areas of alopecia, which we all know is abnormal hair loss. The vet orders some blood tests to determine the cause of the clinical condition. So, first, what tests do you think are appropriate to run on this dog's blood? And what are some examples of endocrine diseases that this dog might have? And then question two, are the treatments for these endocrine diseases safe? And question three, what information should we give to the owner? So a vet tech should be able to adequately explain endocrine diseases to clients and let them know how the treatment of endocrine disease can help their pet. So these are important things for you to know. So first of all, let's talk about question one, what tests are appropriate to run and some examples of diseases the dog might have. So if we're running diagnostic tests on an animal with PUPD, we will always want to do a CBC, biochem profile, so to look at liver, kidney, and glucose status and urinalysis. Endocrine tests like thyroid tests and dexamethasone suppression tests or ACTH stim tests and that sort of thing, if we think that the adrenals might be involved. So possible diagnoses here: hyperadrenocorticism, so Cushing's, hypothyroidism, diabetes mellitus, basically all the things we just talked about. How safe is the treatment for these conditions? Well, that depends on the disease and the treatment that's ultimately chosen by the owner. The side effects of insulin for diabetes is primarily hypoglycemia, so that's the big one. And hypoglycemia could cause seizures, or as I like to say, seizure coma death. If we're treating hyperthyroidism with methimazole, we can get vomiting, diarrhea, lethargy, those sorts of things. Mitotane treatment for Cushing's, if we were going to use mitotane, there's a chance of neurologic signs, lethargy, vomiting, and diarrhea. We don't see that so much with Vetoryl, which is the trilistine. The levels of side effects are related to the severity of the disease and how long the disease has been present in that animal. So what should we tell the owner? Well, they should be advised that endocrine diseases in general might take a long time to regulate, and that diagnostic testing and physical exams should be performed routinely until the condition is regulated. When we first start treating these guys, we have them back all the time. Maybe we're doing glucose curves or other blood work, or we're just checking on their clinical signs. We're weighing them. We're just keeping in touch with the owner. It's very intensive in the beginning to start treating these. The good news is eventually we tend to be able to get these guys kind of out on their own, and they're able to ultimately regulate themselves once the treatment is kind of up and running. Additional testing to monitor the disease itself is warranted. So Even once things seem to be all tickety-boo, we need to at least every, usually every 3 months, maybe every 6 months in some cases, to be checking certain blood values and that kind of thing. So again, the ability to adequately explain these endocrine diseases to clients is really important in order to ensure that owners are going to be compliant with treatment and patient monitoring. Most of the time, these are lifelong treatments, and owners really need to understand what they're getting into, what their role is, and what the possible complications are. I'm going to start talking now about gastrointestinal disease. It is a huge and complex group of diseases, so we're going to focus on basic kind of generic treatment for a lot of gastrointestinal conditions. So these are non-specific supportive therapies usually. And in some cases, when we really know exactly what's going on, there are targeted therapies available. Most of the time with GI disease, we have vomiting and diarrhea, and supportive care is really, really important. So fluids, either IV or sub-Q or sometimes PO for rehydration are necessary. Antinauseants are often used, and antacids. So at the bottom here, obviously here's we have a dog down there with IV fluid therapy. Next to that, there's OES, an oral electrolyte solution. So if we have an animal that's had really bad diarrhea or is continuing to have really bad diarrhea, but not vomiting, we can use oral electrolyte solutions to help these guys recover. Here are our mainstays of symptomatic or supportive therapies for GI disease. First are antiemetics, and these help prevent or stop vomiting. Probably our favorite one at this point is Sirenia, also known as, well, its generic name is meropenem citrate. That's injectable, it works directly on the vomiting center, and very effective anti-nauseant. Prokinetics, that in they increase GI motility, so that's things like sisapride, we'll talk more about that. Antacids, these increase stomach pH because, as we all know, our stomach pH is really, really low, and that can cause a lot of stress on the stomach, especially if it's already inflamed. So, for instance, famotidine. Here's Sirenia. Sirenia is probably my favorite antiemetic. What it does is it blocks substance P in the central nervous system, and that inhibits the vomiting reflex. It's very commonly used now. It's available injectably and in oral form. The oral form is usually used to prevent motion sickness, like for carsick dogs and stuff. It stings when it's injected, so that's important to remember. If you keep it in the fridge, it stings less, but you shouldn't dilute it. I used to dilute it to give it in order to help prevent the stinging, but that apparently does actually affect its efficacy. Be aware with foreign bodies, if you're using Sirenia, it can mask the signs and then the diagnosis can be overlooked. That being said, if you're using diagnostics properly and you're treating them, kind of appropriately, usually you can get away with giving it. But just make sure to ask the vet if you're thinking about giving Sirenia and there's a potential foreign body. Sirenia is an interesting drug. They're finding all kinds of uses for it all the time. It's also been used for things like visceral pain, coughing, urinary pain. It's an anti-inflammatory and it might even have anti-obesity properties. This is often used in cats with chronic upper respiratory infections, like we call it kitty cat snuffles. So these snotty cats that you can't get under control sometimes respond to Sirenia. Very interesting drug. Metoclopramide, some people might call it Reglan. That was its trade name, I think, in the human world. We just call it Metoclope in practice. It is a prokinetic, meaning it stimulates GI motility in the right direction, of course, and antiemetic, stops vomiting. It's another centrally acting drug. It blocks dopamine receptors. So it has some peripheral action as well. It increases the gastric contraction. It speeds gastric emptying, and it strengthens cardiac sphincter tone. So you can see how this would all stimulate motility in the right direction and stop vomiting. It works best in the upper GI tract versus sorry about that versus sisapride, which works in the lower GI tract. It can be given IM, it can be given slow IV, or it can be given orally. An uncommon side effect with metoclopramide is neurological excitement, which involves restlessness, involuntary movement. It's quite actually dramatic to see it. I have seen it once when I worked at Emerge, and I hope to never see it again, but once you've seen it once, you'll recognize it if you ever do see it again. Here's tisapride. Again, another prokinetic. It stimulates the motility of the proximal and distal gastrointestinal tract, and I would say it's used primarily for the distal GI tract. This actually includes the gastroesophageal sphincter, the stomach, small intestine, and the colon. It really helps the whole GI tract move along. The most common use of tisapride by far is for constipated cats. It's not effective for vomiting, so that's why metoclopramide is often chosen above tisapride in those cases. So, side effects of tisapride, diarrhea, maybe, abdominal pain, yes. Abdominal pain I see quite a bit after giving tisapride in a constipated cat. If you can think if you've ever been constipated and then things try to start moving, it does cause quite a bit of discomfort. Antacids, these are typically H2 receptor agonists. They block the activation of H2 receptors by histamine. What that does is it decreases the release of hydrochloric acid into the stomach. So that would decrease the acidity, which is increasing the pH and generally causing everything to be a little happier in there. Famotidine is the one that's most commonly used in dogs and cats, at least. It's very, very commonly used in cats, say with kidney disease and anything with gastrointestinal upset. You do not give it IV in cats. So usually what we used to do is mark all of our bottles of famotidine, which goes in the fridge, by the way. We'd mark it not IV in cats, just so we always remembered that, because it can sometimes cause hemolysis. It's used often orally as well. Pepcid AC, you see that in the bottom right-hand corner, that is famotidine. Ranitidine is still used pretty commonly. It was used very commonly for a long time, but there is some doubt now about how well it actually works in dogs and cats. And in fact, some might argue that in cats it's pretty much useless, and in dogs I've heard the same actually. So I steer clear of Zantac just because I have Pepcid available. So I choose famotidine over ranitidine. There's also cimetidine. It's less potent and it's rarely used in dogs and cats, and I believe it's rarely used in veterinary medicine in general. There are other kinds of antacids. There's proton pump inhibitors like omeprazole. I find we don't use these enough, I don't think, in animals. They bind irreversibly to an enzyme on the surface of parietal cells in the GI tract, and that results in the inability of those cells to secrete acid until they first basically make a whole new enzyme. So they work quite well. There's prostaglandin E1 analogs. What they do is they inhibit those parietal cells again in the GI tract from secreting the hydrogen ions. So misoprostol does this. It's a prostaglandin E1 analog. Very big caution here. Any pregnant animal, this should not be used. It can cause abortions. Gastromucosal protectants. These form a paste-like substance in the stomach, and that binds to the surface of gastric ulcers. Basically, works well in the upper GI tract or the proximal GI tract. And the only one we really use commonly in animals is sucralfate, which usually it comes in this big thick liquid. It's white. It's also available in 1 gram tablets, and they're these big chunky white tablets. So these are used very, very commonly in the cases of gastrointestinal or basically gastric ulceration. I'm just going to stick in here a little word about toxicities. Dietary indiscretion and ingestion of potentially harmful substances. These are very common in the veterinary world. You will often get calls from owners after their pet got into something. In those cases, you should find out what was ingested, when, and how much, and recommend ways to induce vomiting if you think it's appropriate in that case. If they didn't, if they swallowed something like bleach, you don't want them to have to bring that up again, because that's just going to cause more damage coming up. But if it's an appropriate thing to bring up in the vomit, then we can tell clients how to do that, like giving peroxide or sometimes dish soap or that sort of thing. You can consult the vet. You always have that option, which is great. So consult your vet, and or there's a ASPCA has a great poison control website, and you can determine the toxic dose of a lot of ingested substances, including prescription drugs from owners, which is a very common one. Always, if you think it's at all necessary, tell the owners to bring the animal in for supportive care. If you think that toxic effects are possible, best to be on the safe side. All right, now we have GI drug case study. So here we have a teenager calling the clinic. She says she's been babysitting a child and his dog. The dog got into a cupboard and spilled cleaning supplies on the floor. When the babysitter found the dog, he was lapping up some of the chemicals from the floor. She wants to know what she can give the dog to make him vomit up the chemicals. First thing, what should the veterinary technician ask her first? And second, is vomiting warranted in this case? What information is needed before making that decision? And then, what options does the babysitter have at home, or is it better to bring the dog into clinic? First of all, it's really important to find out what chemicals the animal ingested to determine whether the animal needs to have vomiting induced. So the tech needs to ask the client to read the ingredients on the container. That's the only way we have of knowing what kind of toxicity this might be and what kind of noxious substances might be in there. Vomiting isn't recommended for caustic things like ammonia, lye, bleach. If it's unknown whether vomiting should be induced, again, ASPCA website or just contact them directly. The SPCA in Canada doesn't have the same kind of information necessarily easily available. So ASPCA is a nice resource there. You can call them. There is a charge. But if this is a serious case that you think might end up in a really serious toxicity, it's a really good idea to give them a call, and the client will gladly pay that charge if it saves their animal. So if vomiting is indicated, there are some home remedies you can always recommend over the phone. So Ipecac syrup, if they happen to have that. Hydrogen peroxide is very commonly used. Salt and water, mustard and water, and salt followed by food. These are all things that sometimes induce vomiting. It's not immediate, and it can continue for an extended period of time. So you might give these solutions, and it might take a while for the animal to vomit, and then it can continue for quite a while. So basically, the owner can give a home remedy, but the animal should be brought in so that we can give supportive care, say if the vomiting's protracted or anything. Vet tech should also recommend bringing towels in the car, and then that way you can collect the vomit and you can actually look and see if you see what the animal ingested in the vomit. If the owner lives close enough to the clinic, it's best to bring the animal in either way to receive emetics, and that's because we have some nice safe ones that are effective and we know how they work. So we'd always recommend that over giving something at home. However, if they live far away, we may not have that luxury. If you have any questions on these drugs, please feel free to email me or email Bianca. You have our information, and we'll get back to you when we can. And I hope this has been a good refresher for you. There's more to come, so I will be talking to you again soon.